Hello and welcome to the CX Files podcast. I'm your host, Mark Hillary. We have a focus on work from home CX this week. Marcel Stroop is responsible for B2B sales at 5CA, based in Amsterdam in the Netherlands. I saw Marcel sharing some comments on LinkedIn recently where he was describing the difference between remote-friendly CX and remote-first CX. So as 5CA is a company that focuses on offering a completely work-from-home solution, I called him up to find out the difference between the two. Okay, Marcel, thanks for being on the podcast. Now, I know that you posted something on LinkedIn recently, an article that explored the difference between companies that are remote worker friendly and those that are remote first. How would you describe the difference between this?
Yeah, thanks, Mark. And thanks for inviting me over to the podcast, right? It's a great question, and especially the past 5 months this discussion is now going in a very fast pace, right? Because the reality is that most companies will not return to be fully in office, right? I mean, the companies were forced to become remote all of a sudden, and so they had to distribute laptops or create a VPN. Or have policies in place for remote work, you know, virtual meeting rooms. I mean, some companies didn't even have Zooms or Microsoft Teams, right, to do virtual meetings. But now that we are over this first couple of months, you can actually see that there are companies that are remote friendly and that there are companies that are remote first. And typically, I would say that companies that are remote friendly, these are companies that roll out flexible work policies, you know, or they're opening remote hubs to provide some flexibility, yeah, to, for example, retain people longer, especially within the current situation, or expand their talent pool. But I would say that these companies are somehow remote-ish, right? Not really remote. They do embrace remote work, but the work cannot be done fully remote. So they are not really remote first yet. And the interesting thing, right, because of the past 5 months, is that the theory developed here. The theory is now that there is a remote-friendly company and there's a remote-first company. And there's some key characteristics here, which I'd like to walk you through as well. And remote-friendly companies, they allow remote work, but they don't optimize for it, right? So the office is still the way to go. And the office is basically still the heart of the company, I would say, right? So in remote-friendly companies, people are allowed to work from home, but meetings are still synchronized, right? So you still have to actually be in the meeting physically or, you know, through a virtual meeting to actually be able to work for the company. And processes and tools, they revolve around the office. Meetings are scheduled whenever it's convenient for people in the office. And actually, most important, and that's the most important piece on remote-friendly companies, that key decisions are still made in the office. And that's because you have those water cooler conversations, or I always refer to them as the coffee machine conversations. And usually the small bits within the decision-making process are discussed in there. And that's not possible for people who are working remote because they miss those conversations. So actually, to become a remote-first company, you need to completely change the way you think as a company. So remote-first companies, they intentionally, and I think that's a really important thing here, right? Intentionally optimize for remote work. So real-time meetings, right, are kept at a minimum, and they are recorded to be watched by all later on. And the decisions, they are made online, not during the coffee machine conversations, you know, or the small chit-chat here in office. And also an important thing is that performance is measured by output, not the hours worked. And I think a lot of people will like this because unhealthy work cultures, I mean, there has been a debate about this for the past 40 years, right, where if people would come in the office at 8 a.m. in the morning, they would stay late until, for example, 8 or 9 p.m., that would be considered a good person or a good employee. And actually, that's not really the case, right? Because you should actually focus on output. And that's the good thing about remote first, because you focus on output rather than the amount of work put into it. And another thing as well is that communication is asynchronous. And what does asynchronous mean, right? That it doesn't have to happen at exactly the same moment. And it's also something, right, in customer service. You have chat, right? Chat is something real time. But then you have messaging, like WhatsApp or Apple Business Chat, for example, where somebody can message and 3 hours later you get a response. And actually, the quality of the interaction is not affected or hurt by it. So, for me, in short, the theory behind a remote-friendly company and a remote-first company. I think a lot of companies are thinking how they will structure the company in the coming years, especially now that it seems that we will work from home until the end of the year, at least.
Yeah, and that's interesting that you mentioned this focus on transparency, decision-making, measured by output, not hours at the office. I mean, this really seems to be largely a cultural change. So do you think that the companies that were forced to react and they were forced to become remote friendly during the pandemic, I mean, have they had long enough to build this culture during the last 4 months or so?
Yeah, it's a great question again. And I think, to be very blunt and direct here, I don't think they have. I mean, they did not have enough time to build a remote culture. And think about it like as Rome wasn't built in one day. It takes time to create a culture. It takes time to build a culture. It takes time for people to adapt to it. And moreover, it also takes time to build a distributed company. So, I mean, in a distributed company is a company where the workforce reaches beyond the restrictions of a traditional office environment, right? A distributed workforce is usually dispersed geographically, right, over a wide area. That could be either in a country, maybe in the US, for example, or it could be across Europe, or like for example, our company, 5CA, we are distributed across the globe, so from Alaska to South Africa, right, to South Korea. And I believe in the companies that had to move and to send their contact center agents home all of a sudden, that in-office is still the vibe. I mean, these people, they didn't choose to work from home, right? They're now forced to work from home. But eventually, it apparently was there were certain things about the office that actually attracted them, right, to go work for these offices. And moreover, what you see is that things like training, workforce management, traffic control, operations management, guidance, friendship, that still is centralized around the office. I have a bit of theory behind this as well, and I don't want to go too in-depth on this, but the keyword here is distributed, right? Distributed workforce. And if you really want to become remote, this will take time. And in the past months, the theory around distributed workforces has also developed, right? And now there's a common let's say sense that there are six levels of distributed work, where level zero is basically a job cannot be done unless you are really there. And I think that's the case for most contact center agents in the past, right? Because with PCI compliance, with very strict clean desk policies, for example, with the check-in, check-out system, these jobs were centralized and were basically made to work in the office. And then all of a sudden, they had to move to a level where you could actually do this work from home. So that actually takes you to level three already, that you're remote friendly, right? That you at least make sure that people can work remotely. But to truly become distributed, this is a conscious choice, and your company needs to become asynchronous. And eventually it will actually lead you to consistently perform better than any in-person organization. So, the short answer to your question is no. I don't think the traditional contact centers, let's say, had enough time to build a real remote culture. Of course, yes, they can do the work remote now, but I don't believe they can do it sustainably.
Well, one of the opportunities that you get from a distributed workforce is that you can choose people from anywhere, basically. And that means you can raise the bar and you can focus on their domain knowledge and their expertise. So rather than just hiring someone who's got experience of customer service, you can hire someone who's got very specific experience that focuses on the client that you're trying to support. I mean, it must be very different supporting a gamer, you know, so a games publisher compared to supporting a bank. And you must be looking for very different skills in the agents that do those different types of roles. I mean, is this one of the big advantages of being distributed?
Yes, I'm 100% convinced that within customer service, remote work is very beneficial for both the company and ultimately the customer, right, that we are serving here. And yes, there is a difference between a gamer and a bank customer. But I think we shouldn't forget that if you support these either a gamer or a bank from a traditional office, you can recruit these people 50 kilometers in the direct neighborhood of your office. And all of a sudden, when you go remote, you have access to talent, right? You have access to the relevant talent. You have access to the right talent. And it would, for example, mean for a gamer, it would perhaps mean that for gaming clients, you would staff real gamers, so people who actually understand the gamer and can support the gamer at best. And then you would actually focus in the training process on making sure that their customer service skills are trained right. And maybe for a bank customer, you would much rather focus on looking for somebody with the right expertise on customer service already, so with the right soft skills, for example, and with the right educational background, instead of that real domain fit. And that's the benefit, of course, because you can basically decide whichever, right? And what we always say is that remote is flexible and it's scalable, and that flexibility, I think, that's where both customers and companies will really profit from. And then there's another thing. It's the employee retention. And what you typically see in remote companies is that employee retention is much higher. And the main reason there, and of course this also applies to an office, but to be successfully working remote, you need to have a high trust culture. So in a high trust culture, people tend to stay for a longer time because they feel valued, right? They feel trusted. Creating that remotely is much easier because you're focused on output, right? And nobody has to trust that they work all the time. And furthermore as well, calmer environments, they promote productivity. They're much less stressful for most persons, which also leads to less burnout and less feeling of being left out of certain conversations. And I think to get back to your question, yes, indeed, like I said, supporting a gamer and supporting bank customers, that's a different thing. But remote allows you to find profiles that fit perfectly within both those domains. And maybe for one domain, you need a different profile than the other domain. But that's the best thing, right? Because you have over 1 billion people that are available to work from home tomorrow for the company. And maybe to focus a bit on gaming, right? And of course, gaming is 5CA's expertise, and why it works so well for us is that we have a group of people already that are quite used to be indoors and to work independently. And they also, they do value this personal contact, but they are also used already to get in touch with their peers, right, through a remote setup, because gamers, I mean, they are communicating with each other digitally all the time. And that's why, for example, that's why gaming was one of our launching verticals for this. But because of gaming, we learned a lot of lessons that we now are using reusing basically to also staff in the verticals of, for example, a bank or a telecom or digital economy, for example.
Okay, and I know that 5CA is completely work from home. You know, your agents are all based at home. But if you look at the wider customer service industry, you know, most of the big players are all focused on using contact centers. They've all been forced to adopt a work from home model because of the pandemic. But I looked at some McKinsey research just this week, actually, and they said that all of these big guys are going to be leaving 30 to 60% of their agents at home. So the big customer service players are now going to be adopting a hybrid model. Now, I'm sure that you would obviously support the model that 5CA has, but what are the kind of problems that you might see with that hybrid model that people are starting to adopt across the industry?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. And I mean, To be very honest, 5CA, we have 15 years of work from home experience. We are now over 5 years fully work from home. So yes, we have worked in this hybrid setup as well. But you do see that a hybrid setup is not the same as being fully remote. And there's I think, two things to bring to the table here. And in most hybrid setups, and the hybrid setups I read about, is that the agent work, that's the work that will be done remotely. But all the other supporting departments, like workforce management, ops management, traffic control, for example, but also the business intelligence, they will still be run from an office. And this basically leads to a problem, I would say, because this will, again, cause synchronous communication, right? So you have this in-office culture versus the work-from-home culture. So you will get, I mean, the hybrid workforce, let's say the people working remotely will never feel at the same level as your in-office staff. So I do believe that a hybrid company can work, but then at all levels, there need to be people working from home. So also in top management. And it will also mean that if you have a meeting in office and only one person is not able to physically attend this meeting, then you should actually all dial into the meeting from your desk, because otherwise you will never have an equal, equal playing field, right? So hybrid setups, they can work, but we moved away from it because eventually you want to become remote first, because you want the whole company to feel like they work for the same, the same company, right? And within a hybrid company, it's a big challenge to actually make everybody feel like they work for the same company and are equally important.
Yeah, I think that culture around decision making is clearly the key there. You don't want to create people who think that they're in the second division.
Yeah.
Okay, we talked earlier about culture, and I think we were focusing mainly on corporate culture, but you know, I've seen companies trying to introduce things like happy hours, quizzes, you know, so they're trying to get the people to bond as a team. So not just to work together using Slack and Zoom and all these other tools, but actually to have a beer together and get to know each other. I mean, you guys are completely 100% work from home. So what's worked for you? I mean, how do you bring a virtual team and get them to actually enjoy working together?
Yeah, this is actually one of the key questions, right, to make remote work. And for us, engagement and bringing across the 5CA culture to our remote employees is something we've invested in a lot from the start already. And I think it also, I mean, don't get me wrong, quizzes and happy hours, they are fantastic. And yes, it will help to create that one team feeling. But it all starts first with trust. That's number one. And that's, of course, a cultural thing. The second thing is as well, that's much more a mission and vision thing. It's creating a purpose. People need to have the feeling that they're working for a purpose, like for a vision of the company. And that will also make them feel part of the company. And the moment trust and purpose are in place, then you can focus actually on all the little engagement things, like all those 1% things that actually add up to the 100%. And some things that work for us, for example, we have, in some offices you have like a idea, a box, right, where you can leave your envelope with a specific improvement. We have an improvement manager that you can approach. We created an online platform for it, and then that platform is called Cerebro. And actually, everybody can just send in their thoughts on improvements for the company. Same thing, we created a digital community in Yammer, right? The Microsoft social media tool. We do a lot of community surveys to actually test, okay, how is our remote community feeling? What should we do better? Also sharing with them what we actually do with the results of these surveys. Because eventually, I mean, conducting a survey is one thing, right? But also acting on it is another thing. Then we have things like with the mentor program. So we connect people in higher management, for example, with somebody who is still in a different phase of their career to actually make sure that they have a mentor within the company to make them grow. We do company stand-ups. We have initiatives like Community Week. And the Community Week, these are different initiatives. So, for example, 1 month ago, there was Pride Month, right? The Pride Month to actually celebrate that everybody can be themselves in the company. And maybe for us in Western Europe, this is, or in the US, this is a very normal thing. But don't forget, we work in a distributed with a distributed workforce, right? So, for a lot of people in our company, it's actually great to hear that we support this whole Pride Month. And then it's also about celebrating success. So we have quarterback awards, and we 5 years ago, when we moved from hybrid to remote first, we prioritized the remote workforce. And now, actually, because everybody's remote, we just we celebrate the success by handing out quarterback awards to people that support our core values. And I can go on and on and on here, Mark, but there's a lot of these specific 1% things. And of course, it's for every company to find out themselves what they need to achieve. But the most important thing is we have a separate department, an engagement department, that focuses on all these initiatives to actually make sure that we keep focusing on the engagement and creating this positive culture within the company.
Yeah, and I think it was great that, before all the little 1% changes, like the happy hour and the quizzes, you said that if you don't build a purpose and a culture of trust, then there's no point having a Friday night happy hour.
That's completely correct. It's something you see with a lot of startups as well, right? That they, for example, they have the free lunch, or they have the ping pong table, for example. But actually, what you should focus on is your culture, your open and transparent culture, your purpose, what are you working on? And of course, along the road, you can do all these kind of smaller things, right? Like going out for lunch together, doing happy hours. And yes, these are important, but eventually these will never be successful if people don't feel valued and feel trusted.
Thanks for listening to the CX Files podcast. Please take a moment to review the podcast, because this helps other listeners to find it. And if you have any suggestions, then get in touch with me on Twitter or LinkedIn. I'm @MarkHillary with 2 L's. Or just search Google for Mark Hillary.